This week on Jerusalem Dateline, remembering the Holocaust, Israel and the world commemorate the disaster that decimated Europe's Jews. Plus, for most kids, summer camp is a chance to make new friends. But in the Gaza Strip, summer camp is a place to learn how to become a terrorist. And above and beyond, how a small band of American Jewish pilots helped win Israel's independence. Hello and welcome to this edition of Jerusalem Dateline. I'm Chris Mitchell. We're coming to you with the Tower of David behind me. It's not really the Tower of King David, but a couple of hundred years ago when Christian pilgrims would come to the Holy Land, the tower was the first thing they saw. And since it was the city of King David, they called it the Tower of David. Well, this week, from Auschwitz to the United Nations to Israel, millions of people around the world commemorated International Holocaust Remembrance Day. Ceremonies marked the death of 6 million Jews, what some call the greatest crime in history. The world remembered the Holocaust, but for survivors, the memories never fade.
There is not one day when we don't think about the events hidden in our minds. There is not one day. It always returns. Dreams return. We still hear in our dreams dogs barking, those German commands.
In Auschwitz, more than 50 Knesset members joined Holocaust survivors and world leaders to mark the liberation of the worst of the Nazi death camps. They shared memories of the place where Nazis murdered more than 1 million Jews, where life expectancy of those arriving was sometimes measured in minutes.
Dogs were barking, and there was a terrible smell. We didn't know what the smell was. We could only see the chimneys with flames a couple of meters high. We didn't know that it was the crematorium.
At the UN, filmmaker Steven Spielberg shared the hope of Holocaust survivors.
Survivors and witnesses often say that their dearest hope, the hope that helped keep them alive, was to be heard and to be believed and to be understood.
Spielberg made Schindler's List. The movie told the story of Oskar Schindler, who saved thousands of Jews during the Holocaust, like Rena Finder.
Oskar Schindler has proven, like a shining star, that there is always something somebody can do.
On International Holocaust Remembrance Day, over and over around the world, whether at Auschwitz, the UN, or here in Jerusalem at Yad Vashem, Israel's National Holocaust Museum, the refrain was the same, never again.
When we say that phrase, never again, it shouldn't just be something that we say without thinking. It should mean that we are taking an active stance, that we don't want something like that to happen ever again.
It's important to come here and to give testimony that we were prisoners. It should be a lesson. Such events shouldn't happen again.
Theirs were journeys into the Holocaust. They cannot emerge from it, and neither can the world until there are no more genocides, until the unthinkable becomes impossible.
Recently, Hamas officials celebrated a gruesome achievement, the graduation of 13,000 high school students who completed 6 days of terrorist training in camps throughout Gaza. But it's nothing new for the terrorist group. As John Waggy reports, Hamas has been turning children into jihadists for years.
Hamas is recruiting a new wave of kids to become the fighters of the future. The Gaza camps prepare children at an early age to hate and kill the Jews. Itamar Marcus monitors the hate education in Gaza and the West Bank.
There are a couple of levels to turning an innocent child into a terrorist. The first one is pumping him up with hatred. The second one is training him with weaponry.
The U.S. is pushing hard for a two-state solution between Israel and the Palestinians. But in Hamas-run Gaza, they prefer a one-state solution without Israel. And they're raising up a new generation to try to make that happen.
We manufacture everything locally in order to strike Zionists. We will strike you anywhere, kill you and defeat you until you leave our land.
Samir, a bomb maker, also serves as a mentor to both teens and preteens.
I started since I was 14 years old to learn how to make bombs and resist the Jews. Now I'm able to make hand grenades and landmines.
Here he explains how they make a local anti-tank landmine and how to wire them and fill them up with explosives.
Now we manufacture a local grenade. It is a plastic tube. We fill it up with TNT and wrap it up with tape, and here's the result.
The sound of explosions is followed by cheers from kids from ages 12 to 16. CBN News followed a cell of five boys.
We don't play like other kids because we are part of jihad since we were children. We have to kick the Jews out of our land and liberate Jerusalem.
This 15-year-old instructor shows off his rifle and grenades.
The weapon's name is Carlo and it is made by our people. Here is the ammo clips with the bullets in it. It is ready to fire. Here is a sound grenade. And this one is an explosive grenade.
See, this is a tremendous empowering of the child. He feels like he is in control. He knows how the weapons work. It's making him feel way, way beyond his age. And making him feel like he's going to be a fighter. He's going to kill with this.
Marcus has a word for Westerners about how to understand terror.
I always tell people, take off your cultural glasses and put on the glasses of the other culture. You wake up in the morning and you rush to the newspaper to see how your baseball team did last night. And these people get up in the morning and they're praying for the destruction of the Christian and Jewish world and replaced by Islam, that we shall finally win the Crusader Wars. It's a different worldview.
Despite the children's innocent faces, their teachers incite them to choose the way of death.
That many or some of these people might in the future participate in terror is certainly something that everybody should be concerned about.
John Waggy, CBN News, at the Israeli-Gaza border.
This week, Colonel Oliver North spoke to the 10th annual Knesset Christian Allies Caucus celebration. The caucus is a group of Christian organizations and Knesset members to support Israel. North told CBN News why it's so important for America to stand with Israel.
What happens to Israel happens to us. Their enemies are our enemies. Their friends are our friends. And the destiny of our country, Ronald Reagan said, we have a rendezvous with destiny. The destiny of our country is tied intrinsically to the destiny of this country. We in America need never forget that. And they need to know that there are people like us who worship the same God, who pray every day for this country.
Up next, did the recent agreement with Iran really put a halt to its nuclear weapons program? We speak to a former national security official who says it actually does just the opposite. Welcome back. An Iranian foreign ministry spokesman said that his country's path to nuclear development is irreversible. Meanwhile, a former Bush administration national security official said the Iran agreement allows that country to pursue nuclear weapon development. Elliot Abrams made the comments during a recent interview with Gary Lane.
You know, first of all, there's three legs for a nuclear weapon. There's the enrichment, the centrifuges and all of that. There's missiles and there's a warhead. This agreement says nothing about stopping them from developing a warhead, and it says nothing about stopping them from developing their missiles. It just focuses on enrichment. And everybody says, no, it's a real good agreement, you see, because they're going to turn their 20% enriched uranium into other forms. They're going to convert it into oxide or other forms that are not useful for weaponry. If you look a little further, you see that they've promised to convert it as soon as they have the capability to do that. A kind of a factory or plant that can do that conversion. They don't have it now. Now, are they going to set it up in February? They're going to set it up in March? They're going to set it up in April? Who knows? At the end of 6 months, it may be that they've found unfortunate delays, and that means that they will not have converted any or much of that 20% uranium. They may be that much closer to a weapon. Now, the IAEA has talked about the military uses, the military program the Iranians have, this warhead program, and asked for information. Under this agreement, we don't talk about their access to military sites and about the warhead. It seems to me that the Iranians don't pay much for this agreement and they're going to get a huge benefit. The sanctions are being eroded. In previous years, we always had the sense, more sanctions, ratcheting up, tougher sanctions. We've turned a corner here. And the sanctions for the first time are starting to be lifted. And you see in the newspapers every day, businessmen from all over, India, France, Germany, Italy, are rushing to Tehran to do new deals because they think this will never be turned around. We climbed up the hill, now we're starting to climb down.
It seems like a reversal of 30 years of U.S. foreign policy on Iran, is it?
It is. And you know, that would be fine if we had a good, tough nuclear agreement, which is what we all want. They really stopped their nuclear program. We stopped the sanctions. I don't think they've stopped their nuclear program. They've never done anything that would so alarm the West, the Americans, the Israelis, that there'd be any kind of military attack. Slow and steady wins the race has been the way they've been approaching this. I think they may slow down now a little bit, but they're still moving forward toward nuclear weapons capability.
So do you think this president doesn't care about Iran developing a nuclear weapon?
I think he sees a problem with a nuclear Iran between now and the end of his term. I mean, he's made so many speeches about how you know they can't do that, we won't let them do that, that I think would create a huge problem for him if one day, say, they test a nuclear device. I think he wants to kick the can down the road 3 more years until he's not president.
Well, he had a red line on Syria, and he didn't do anything about that.
I think the red line on Iran is tougher. You know, the red line on Syria, he said it once off the cuff in a Q&A interview. I think he probably regretted saying it. This is different. He's on the record here 25 times, including during his visit to Israel. I will not permit. In the beginning, he said, they will not be permitted. Passive voice. Then he got active voice. I will not permit. So I think he can't actually permit it. So if the Iranians are headed that way and you can't permit it, what do? Try to slow it down. Try to keep them from doing it over the next 3 years. Probably take them a year or two anyway. And I think he would also like to stop the Israelis from doing anything. Now, I would ask the question, of course, what happens if the Iranians are about to do it? Would he change his view of an Israeli strike? And I think the answer may be yes, under those circumstances.
Analysts disagree on actually how close Iran is to getting a nuclear bomb. Abrams says regardless, the Islamic regime is closer than ever. You can hear more of Abrams' comments on Gary Lane's blog, The Global Lane, at cbnnews.com. Coming up, the untold story of the founding of Israel's Air Force. A small band of Americans went above and beyond to help save the Jewish state. In 1948, Israeli leaders declared an independent Jewish state. Immediately, the surrounding Arab nations invaded, trying to drive the Jews into the sea. Against overwhelming odds, Israelis defeated those Arab armies, what some call a miracle. But an upcoming documentary says they also had help from a little-known band of American Jewish pilots. Here's a preview of Above and Beyond.
Minot, North Dakota, partners in a used car and truck business. Money, girlfriends, cars, the whole enchilada. When I got this phone call from New York.
I got a letter from a friend of mine at TWA, called this number and asked for Swifty, just like that. So what the hell, I called the number. Livingston, where the hell are you? We've been waiting a week for you. I said, waiting for me? Yeah, we need you right away.
I said I'd wear a flying jacket, so a leather jacket, so they would recognize me. And they said to bring a logbook of proof that I was a pilot.
They're meeting at a hotel on 57th Street in New York, the Henry Hudson Hotel. Served great martinis.
A fellow who identified himself as Steve Schwartz, apprising me of the fact that Israel was going to declare itself a state, that they were going to be attacked by at least 5 Arab armies,
and they had no way to defend themselves except that they had purchased some airplanes, but they had no one to fly them. And would I be in a position to help?
The idea that Jews were going to fight, I found exciting. It's about time.
It wasn't like a newspaper had joined the Haganah. It was illegal, of course. I said, look, I know there's going to be a war there, and I'm a fighter pilot, and I want to go there.
And I had just made up my mind that nothing was going to stop me. I couldn't live with myself if I didn't do this.
The alternative is too hard for me to envision, the possibility of what the Arabs could have done. And they talked about the fact that what Hitler did will be nothing compared to what we're going to do. You know, you're talking about 600,000 Jews and 50 million Arabs surrounding them. I didn't see how they could possibly survive.
The Arab countries had established air forces. We had almost nothing. Four junk airplanes. Different propeller, different engines from spare parts that the German Air Force left behind in Czechoslovakia.
I remember sitting in the cockpit of my ME-109 wearing a German uniform, a German helmet, a German parachute. What's a nice Jewish boy from St. Paul doing in a place like this? The irony of it did not escape any of us.
The Arabs had squadrons, they had planes, they had tanks, they had guns, they had everything, except that will to win that the Israelis had, that they had to win.
He says, look, 6 miles from where we're standing now at the airbase is the whole Egyptian army of about 10,000 men, about 500 vehicles, tanks, trucks, and tankers, and we have nothing to stop them. I said, well, tomorrow I was going to go. He says, if you don't go now, they'll be in Tel Aviv in the morning and there's no Israel.
These airplanes had never been test flown. They were assembled in the hangar. And they just started up, taxed out, and attacked the Egyptian army coming up the coast.
I looked back, and I saw the land of Israel. I looked there, I saw the enemy that came to destroy us. I just did a quick Shema Yisrael, even though I'm not religious. Turned the airplane upside down because the dive bomb, the steeper the dive, the more accurate is the hit.
I told Lou, this is about the dumbest thing that I'd ever heard of, and I would never have done it, but they stopped the Egyptians cold.
I felt more at home in Israel than I did in the United States. I felt this is my home. As a Jew, I now felt proud of being Jewish.
I was born to be here in that moment of history to contribute to Israel's survival.
I had done something good for once.
We built an air force. We started an air force.
If you wrote the history of the Jewish people 1,000 years from now, there are two things that I can tell you will be in it. One is the Holocaust, one is the birth of the State of Israel. The people who went to Israel and participated in this effort were, you know, really part of two of the most significant, incredible, devastating, tragic, euphoric episodes in Jewish history, I think for all time.
Shortly before I left, I happened to be in Tel Aviv when they were bringing in refugees from the death camps in Europe, I remember them getting down on their hands and knees and kissing the ground. I knew then and there that was the reason that I came.
Up next, the leader of one of the world's largest women's organizations speaks out about Israel. Finally this week, Jane Hansen is the president of Women's Aglow, one of the world's largest women's organizations, with representatives in 170 countries. At this Knesset Christian Allies Caucus celebration, Hansen was given an award for her contribution to Israeli tourism. And during her acceptance speech, she said that Israel was a test for the nations.
I mean, on the authority, based on the authority of God's word and what he has stated about the Jewish people and the land of Israel, ultimately, mankind, all of mankind, will be tested as to whether or not they will bow their knee and their hearts to the God of Israel. Israel functions under a divine mandate to survive, and he has established this people and this land for himself. He said, I will make Zion my dwelling place. So on the basis of his word, it will become a test for everyone as to whether or not they submit to the authority of his word.
Well, that's it for this edition of Jerusalem Dateline. I'm Chris Mitchell. Shalom from Jerusalem.